The Matata Wildlife Reserve, home to native bird life, the Waitepuru stream, and a taniwha.
It had a long, sinuous body that came down the Bay of Plenty. And this particular pūrākau said there's a taniwha and you want to beware its flicking tail.
In 2005, he didn't just flick his tail, he thrashed it. A single day of acute rainfall caused flash floods that decimated Matata.
This tumultuous mix of sediment and water and trees and boulders, you know, some of those boulders are the size of cars.
A landslide of rock, wood and mud came thundering through, destroying 27 properties in its path.
Pūrākau we can think of as stories, as myths, as legend, drawn from observations of phenomena in the landscape and explained according to a Māori worldview.
In Matata in 2005, the town's three marae were untouched.
And to me, that's absolutely no mistake because they had created a disaster reduction mechanism, i.e. the taniwha, to say, look, don't build there. And so Pūrākau can help us as we look to understand what the impacts of climate change might be and then make decisions around what we do.
Aotearoa is an island nation. We live and always have lived by the water. It's a way of life that means we have to wrestle with two types of flooding, coastal from the sea or fluvial from the river. And if you haven't experienced a burst river, you'd be forgiven for assuming the same places keep ending up underwater.
We tend to talk about the impacts of flooding where we see it and experience it the most or the worst. And so therefore, it's newsworthy and we keep going back to those places.
Edgecombe, Whanganui, Christchurch, all built on floodplains and regularly in the news. But Aotearoa has thousands of rivers.
New Zealanders are really good at living too close to rivers that flood. I think the statistic is that about two-thirds of New Zealanders live on a floodplain.
New studies show that in climate change's extreme scenarios, almost 700,000 people and over 400,000 buildings are at risk. Severe storms could critically damage $135 billion worth of property.
I can imagine that there will be plenty of other matata type examples. There may well have been taniwha pūrākau for many of those places where that example is the same.
Here is the Ruamahanga River, winding through the Wairarapa Valley. But the water that we can see, calm or choppy, is only a snapshot of its life. Now, light imaging can show us how the Ruamahanga has behaved over centuries. It hasn't always followed one path. It snakes through the valleys, flooding, looping, receding. The land remembers, and this memory is a beautiful record of its forms. Because where the river has been tells us where the river might go as climate change brings more extreme rainfall and more flooding.
For some people, it will be not should we shift the marae, it's where will we shift the marae to.
But taniwha don't only live in our rivers.
There are also taniwha that exist in the marine realms. Often they're associated with places with extremely turbulent waters, but not exclusively.
Amongst the turbulence in our oceans is one undeniable truth. It is rising.
Sea level rise is more predictable than temperature rise or rainfall change. In the Pacific Island nations, we're already seeing people struggling, communities struggling with sea level rise.
When we are studying now, that's where the houses are. The houses were here before. And just during this damages, all the houses is gone.
And guess what? We're just an island in the Pacific.
New Zealand's seen about 20 centimetres of sea level rise in the last 100 years.
Again, the same few places often make the news. Hector and Granite on the west coast, South Dunedin, Auckland's Tāmaki Drive. But many parts of Aotearoa are at risk of coastal flooding. The Hokianga, the Upper Kaipara Harbour, Whangapaua, Whitianga, Mount Maunganui, Central Tauranga, Napier, Hokitika and Invercargill, to name only a few. Right now, about 72,000 people and 50,000 buildings are exposed to extreme coastal flooding, meaning a storm landing at the same time as a king tide.
Whether or not we cross some kind of tipping point there and lock in metres and metres of sea level rise does depend on how warm it gets. We know for sure that another 30 centimetres is guaranteed, whatever we do now, within the next 40 years or so.
A third of a metre, lock it in. And with every 10 centimetres the seas rise, 7,000 more buildings are exposed.
A city like Wellington, with half a metre of sea level rise, the 1 in 100 year coastal flood happens every couple of weeks. You know, there are trillions of dollars of infrastructure all over the world and billions of dollars just within New Zealand and dozens of communities at risk, even from a few tens of centimetres of sea level rise.
With uninterrupted carbon emissions and the large-scale collapse of ice sheets, by 2130 the sea could rise by 1.5 metres. In a storm surge, many places will be at risk, like Auckland's eastern suburbs, or huge areas of residential Christchurch.
Where I'm from in the Whangaroa district, we've got 14 of our hapu threatened by sea level rise. And so we're gonna have to relocate probably 14 of our villages and head for higher ground.
Let's look closer. In the Hutt Valley right now, here's what could flood during an extreme storm surge. And here's what's under threat from a surge if the sea rises by 1.5 metres. If a storm strikes at the same time as a king tide, the flooding could severely hit Pitoone and Waifutu. At its peak, the water could reach the Hayward Hills, flow through Woburn, and even make it to Railway Road in Alicetown. The total cost to the community could be hundreds of millions of dollars.
What's happening is the coastline's moving inland. We need to move with the coastline.
Our beaches and cliffs are a natural defence from the ocean's power, but in the coastal erosion battle, they're losing.
That's what happens. The sea wins, ultimately, always.
Some insurance companies already refuse to cover some of our most expensive seaside properties.
It's one thing to have to sell your batch, but when you're talking about shifting your whole village away, where do you find the land? Who's going to pay for it? Is it every person for themselves, or are you going to shift collectively as a whole community? If you can't do that and you have to disperse, well, that's the end of your people.
But right now, in 2020, it isn't too late. If our emissions are lowered, by 2100, the sea may only rise by 0.5 metre, only 20 centimetres more than what's already guaranteed.
We've got to prepare and that we've got to take action. There's no good waiting for the waves to be crashing through the marae window before we sit up and go, oh my God, what was that? What are we going to do?
If we do take action now, an extreme storm surge in the Hutt Valley could have a significantly lessened impact. Hundreds of properties and millions of dollars could be spared.
Taniwhas are amazing things to me, and one of their roles is that they act as guardians. When I was a kid, a taniwha was this thing that lived in the dangerous kind of corner of the river that ate you. How can that be my guardian? In Matata, the local people knew about the taniwha. They built their marae out of the harm's way of the lizard. And so the taniwha becomes your guardian if you know about it and if you act accordingly.
Unlike those in our storybooks, our taniwha aren't trying to harm us. They're trying to warn us.